Welcome to Call to Worship, coming to you from First Baptist Church in Eminence, Kentucky, a church where the cross is lifted up. And now let's join the congregation and Reverend Charles H. Duncan, Jr., the new pastor of First Baptist Church, Eminence.
Our invocation by Reverend Robert J. Fields. Our Old Testament scripture will be coming from Licentra Michael Thomas. The New Testament scripture will be coming from Reverend Wilbur Goatley, Jr.
Let us turn our hearts to the word of prayer. Most holy and all righteous Father, it is again that we humble ourselves before your throne of mercy. Father God, we thank you for allowing us to come to the second watch of the day. Because Father God, all of us know you didn't have to do it. But oh Lord God, we're glad you did. And then too, Father God, as we come right now, We come to say thank you for all of your many blessings that you have bestowed upon all your children. And now, Father God, we ask that thou would be in the midst of this service today, that thou would bless us in a Christian way, oh Father God, in love and fellowship. And in truth, Father God, we ask that thou may bless the man of God as he shall come and declare your word. And in truth, Father God, we ask that I may bless each one, oh Father God, who's here today. And oh Father God, if it's one here that do not know you and the pardon of their sins, that thou would touch their heart and allow them to come saying, what must I do to be saved? And now, Father God, we thank you for this young Joshua. Oh Father God, who you have put here to lead these your people. And then to Father God, help him. Go with him and stand by him. Strengthen him. Because Father God, we do know the road would be hard, but Father God, we know that you're able to do everything but fail. And now, Father God, continue to go with us and stand by us. And then create us a clean heart and a right spirit, where we may not sin against thee, when we forever lift you up. For in our darling Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. We give glory, give honor, give thanks in his precious name. Amen.
Amen. Our scripture will be Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 10. Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 10. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones, and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Again he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and ye shall live. And ye shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, but there was no breath in them. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came unto them, and they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. May God add a blessing to the reading, to the hearing of his word.
Our New Testament passage will be from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 11 through 21. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11 through 21. And it reads, but thou, O man of God, flee these things, and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show, who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who giveth us richly all things to enjoy, that they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen. May the Lord bless the readers, hearers, and doers of his word.
We will now have the welcome from Deacon George Blade, a selection from the choir, a response to the welcome from a guest, and greetings from Reverend Michael Duncan.
I say good evening.
Good evening.
Give honor to the head of my life and the head of the church and all of you, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And to him be glory, mercy, grace, and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ ever. And to all distinguished guests, federal, state, and local level, to all ministers, God's children, to our beloved elect new pastor, Reverend Charles Duncan and his wife, to our pastor who's just going to leave us, Reverend Goatley, I hate to see him go, all distinguished guests, dear Christian friend and fellow travelers of the Church of Jesus Christ, I welcome you in the name of Jesus to this grand occasion in the installation of our new pastor who we love. We loved a long time ago before you were new pastor. And you know why we love him? Because he's like a pastor leaving us. He preached the gospel.
Amen.
If you don't preach the gospel, you ain't preaching. I said it in the gold house down there. I said, Reverend and I has never had a crossword. Whole 45 years he's there. You know the reason why? I'm glad you asked me a question. He preached Jesus. And I'm serving Jesus. Well, I ain't got nothing against him. I'm for him.
Yeah, that's right.
That man preaching Jesus. I ain't got nothing for him, against him. I'm for him. You preach Jesus. And his father preaches Jesus. I know him well. So Reverend Charles Duncan Sr., when he comes up here and we meet, we talk. We don't talk about this, that, no, we talk about Jesus.
That's right.
Amen.
And I want to tell each and every one of y'all, if you don't know Jesus, you don't know nothing. So in the name of Jesus Christ, and our beloved pastor, we welcome you once, we welcome you twice, we welcome you again. Amen.
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 No! I have listened to a lot of choirs. I think this is the first choir I've listened to from the back side. As good as they sounded from the backside, I don't know whether I could have stood it if I had been out front. Well, if you take a good look at me, you'll know that I lack some pigment from the other Duncans who are here today. But I want you to know that in my heart, I am this man's brother. And I have grieved the leaving of Dr. W.H. Goatley from this place. You who are part of this congregation have heard me say on numerous occasions, he became the man who welcomed me here in 1979 when I arrived. And he has been someone with whom I've walked alongside for the past 24 years. My grief is lessened because of who this church has called to be your next pastor. I cannot think of anyone with whom I am more excited and pleased to know that I'll be walking alongside my brother, Charles Duncan, in the coming years of our ministry in this place. Reverend Duncan, I got to thinking about what you're taking on today. And I got to thinking about my beginning and the first time I was installed as a pastor. And I looked back at that and I thought, I was young, I was wet behind the ears, I had no earthly idea what I was getting into by becoming a pastor. So I can be forgiven. You know everything about what you're getting into. You come from a pastor's family. You have been part of the outgoing pastor's family. You've been part of the leadership of this church, and still you are about to become its pastor. I was reminded as I thought about that, that in truth, it is only a fool who would aspire to become pastor of any congregation. It is only a greater fool who, when the call of God comes through the hands and voices of a congregation, would refuse to step behind this sacred desk and begin that awesome journey of pastoring people. It is an awesome task that you began. It is made more awesome by the fact that you are stepping into the shadow, a long shadow, of a man who has walked in this place for 45 years. The good news is, his is not a shadow of death. It is life. And in the shadow of his life, you will take root, you will grow, and one day, without knowing it, you will have stepped beyond the shadow into which you walked to become the maker of the next shadow that will fall in this place. I likened a few weeks ago Dr. Goatley to Moses. And I commented that in this community, he has been the one who heard not only the cries of his people, but the cry of our people. And that he dared to walk into Egypt and to guide not just this church, but to guide this community from bondage of Egypt through the wilderness of horrific times when tensions between our races were so horrible, and to bring us to a new land where the presence or absence of pigment doesn't determine whether we call each other brother and sister in Christ. And so today, Reverend Duncan, I liken you to Moses' successor. a young man named Joshua, that the mantle of leadership would fall upon. As God began the process of dismissing Moses and of calling Joshua forth, it was an awesome message he had. For he looked out at his people and he told Moses that these people whom he had brought from slavery to the promised land would again someday turn to other gods. And they would play the harlot from the God who had set them free. And that there would have to be someone who would remind them from whence they had come, what had been given them, and where they were yet to go. The promised land keeps shifting for us. Maybe it keeps shifting because we keep drifting. But when we drift, if there is not a sound word from God, we lose the promised land into which we have been brought. And so, Reverend Duncan, as God said to Joshua when the mantle of leadership passed, I think he says to you, be strong, be courageous, for you shall bring the people of Israel into the land that I swore to give them. I will be with you. You forget everything else, but if you will remember this one thing, God has said, I will be with you. As long as you know that, there is no challenge to which you cannot rise. There is no heartache from which you cannot recover. There are no mountains which you will not be able to climb. No valley so deep that you cannot climb into it and find your way out. No wilderness so massive that you will not see a path through it. I will be with you. Never, never, never forget. For there will be days when you will stand in this pulpit, when you will sit in your study and lie in your bed, and you will feel very much alone. But you will not be, for the God who called you forth will never forsake you and will never leave you. On behalf of the Eminence Council of Churches, the people of this community, I welcome you to a new role and look forward to locking heart and hand and walking with you in the work to which God has called us. God bless you, my brother, my friend.
Reverend Michael Duncan is the pastor of the Eminence Baptist Church. Reverend Charles Duncan Jr. is going to be the newly installed pastor of the First Baptist Church. So that means the Duncans are going to team up in Eminence. Yes, sir.
That may just mean North and the South would finally come
together. All right. And as we say in St. Louis, won't nobody be mad but the devil.
When our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ ascended back to his Father and our Father, he gave grace gifts to the church. He gave some churches apostles, gave some churches prophets, gave some churches evangelists, gave some churches pastors and teachers. First Virginia Avenue Missionary Baptist Church was given the speaker for the hour, Reverend Charles Henry Duncan, Sr. He is a grace gift given to the church. I have known him all the days of my life. I heard his first sermon, and I heard his last sermon he preached today at 11 o'clock. I know him very well. When he's happy, he preaches God's word. When he's sad, he preaches God's word. When he's grieving, he preaches God's word. When he's mad at his children, he preaches God's word. When he's mad at his wife, he preaches God's word. When he's mad at his church, he preaches God's word. I can guarantee you that today he will preach the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ to install his son, Reverend Charles Duncan, Jr. So I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. Reverend Charles Duncan, Sr.
Reverend Charles Duncan, Sr.
Preach God's word.
Preach God's word.
Reverend Charles Duncan, Sr.
Reverend Charles Duncan, Sr.
Preach God's word.
Preach God's word.
Now, this is something he says all the time. He probably will say it today. Preach, Charles Duncan.
Lead me, guide me, ever reach.
want to go where you want me to go. Yes, I do. I want to do what you want me to do. I want to walk the way you want me to walk. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Oh, yes. All of my steps. All of my steps.
Brother Goatley, my brothers in the ministry, all the friends, the moderator of the Central District Baptist Association, Brother Walker, so much for the introductions. Since God is the owner of the church, the eternal owner. It stands to reason that when a church is without a pastor, God has one. Now, the fact that we do not always call the one that God has does not mean he does not have one. Now the atmosphere is ripe for preaching.
Come on, Duncan. Come on now.
Yes, sir.
And although this is an important occasion, it's preaching time. Preach, Charles Duncan. So there is a word. In the book of Exodus, the fourth chapter of that book, Exodus chapter 4, notice verse 24, and it came to pass by the way in the inn that the Lord met him. That's Moses. And sought to kill him. Most unusual coming from God, isn't it? Then Zipporah, that's Moses' wife, took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son and cast it at his feet and said, surely a bloody husband art thou to me. So he let him go. The Lord then let Moses go. Then she said, a bloody husband thou art. because of the circumcision. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about just one little neglect. Just one little neglect. Let me begin by setting the mannequin in the display window.
Come on, Duncan. Come on.
Then we will come back and dress it. Moses has come from the promise of God that nothing Pharaoh had would be able to stand against Moses and God. He's on his way to Egypt to become installed as pastor of Israel. Are you listening? Previously, he had married a Midianite woman by the name of Zipporah. Moses and Zipporah had a second son, Eliezer, just a few days before beginning the journey into Egypt to take charge of the people of God and to tell Pharaoh, the Lord said, "Let my people go." On the eighth day after the birth of this child, that night, God sought to kill Moses.
All right. Come on, Duncan.
Are you listening? The eighth day was coming to a close. And Eliezer had not been circumcised. That's interesting, isn't it? And so Moses was seized with a sudden illness and was on his deathbed.
Right. Come on now.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
It was a God-inflicted punishment for failing to circumcise his own son.
Amen. All right.
Zipporah picked up a sharp stone, cut away the flesh of her son, hands all bloody, threw it at Moses, said, "Thou art a bloody husband to me." And God healed him. Now, we got to make some sense out of that, don't we? Don't we? Follow me. Earlier, when Moses was 40 years of age, he's 80 now. He thought himself fit for the work of delivering Israel. And he was eager to get ahead before the years began to take its toll upon him. So you know that story. So he run ahead of God and took the life of an Egyptian. And when they found out about it, Moses had to flee to the land of Midian. And it was in that land when God called him. And God gave him certain credentials. Very simple signs, but significant signs that God would be with him. God said to Moses at that burning bush, "What's in your hand?" "Just a shepherd's rod." God said, "Throw it down." Moses threw it down and it became a serpent. And the Bible says Moses jumped back. And God said, "Pick it up." And I believe Moses tried to catch it by the head. God said, "Pick it up by the tail." But any sensible person knows that's the wrong place to pick up a poisonous snake. If you pick him up by his tail, he surely can bite you. But if you grab him behind his head, he can't bite you. God said, "Pick it up by the tail." And I see Moses now. Caught it by the tail. And before the serpent could bite him, it turned back to the rod. And I think Moses might have said, "That's the way to go, Lord. That's the way to go." God said, "Let me assure you just a little more. Put your hand in your robe." God said, "Take it out." Took it out, and his hand was leprous. Flesh falling off of it. Pus oozing from it. Stinking. Lord said, "Put it back in. Take it out." The hand was whole. That's a way to go, Lord. That's the way to go. God said, "Let me give you one more sign. Get you a cup of water. Pour it out on the ground." And it turned to blood. "Now get on down in Egypt and tell Pharaoh that I said, let my people go. Get on down into Egypt and begin to pastor my people and carry them to the promised land." And so Moses is on his way to Egypt. But he's got a Midianite wife. And to the Midianite, circumcision was a mutilation of flesh. And so instead of Moses obeying the word of God, Moses listened to his wife. Watch out, Reverend. Watch out, Reverend. Watch out, Reverend. I told Marcia a few days ago. Now in the sermon, I'm not going to be talking about you.
Come on, Duncan.
How many of you get the picture? God said, "Moses, you're going to be my messenger. I have called you, I have commissioned you, I have ordained you to lead my people into the promised land. You cannot lead my people if you're going to listen to your wife." "You cannot lead my people if you're going to listen to some other group in the church. You cannot lead my people if you're going to try to satisfy everybody in the church. The Lord said, if that's the way you're going to start out, then Moses, I might as well kill you right now. and find me somebody else. Come on, come on.
Come on.
Come on.
Come on, bring it on home.
Now, we cannot say that Moses did not know.
Well,
because God had said previously, every male child ought to be circumcised on the eighth day, so the emblem of the covenant will be in the flesh. Now, how are you going to lead my people when you can't even obey my voice? Come on. How are you going to lead my people when I tell you one thing and your wife tells you another? Or some group tells you another.
Yeah.
Or some boy tells you another.
Yeah.
Moses,
yeah.
You better listen to me.
Yeah.
Are you listening?
Come on.
Are you listening?
Come on.
Now evidently, Moses was so sick until he couldn't do it himself. So Zipporah, who understood what was happening.
Well,
I'm about to lose my husband.
All right.
My children are about to lose their father.
Right.
Somebody better do something. Grabbed a sharp stone.
Yeah.
Didn't want to do it, but had sense enough to know, if I don't intervene, this is going to be all of Moses. Because the Lord has sought to kill him.
Yes,
it's right there in the Bible.
Yes, sir.
And when I read that, I had to do some thinking about it. The Lord sought to kill him.
Yes.
The Lord doesn't have to seek to kill anybody.
Yes.
All God has to do is raise his hand and speak the word.
Yes.
So I come to the conclusion that the writer, speaking anthropomorphically, is trying to get us to understand about God.
Yeah.
Moses, you've angered God.
Yeah.
And God, looking for a way to kill you.
Yeah.
The poor said, give me the knife. I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. It's a shame to mutilate males. But the only way to save you is to obey his word.
Yes, sir.
Cut the child. Anyway, took the meat and threw it with Moses. You a bloody husband. And when that was done, God healed Moses. See, there are some lessons that every Moses needs to learn.
Come on.
Come on. And one of the lessons is, when you've been commissioned to lead God's people, when you've been called to tell them what thus saith the Lord, it's dangerous to tell them what the Lord has said and not be doing it yourself. Come on, come on. Are you listening? Now, Moses, you gonna tell them the Lord said, circumcise the males on the eighth day. And you gonna have a son in your own house that has not been circumcised? God said it doesn't work like that. If you're going to say, thus saith the Lord, then be sure you've done what the Lord said do. Moses must learn that service to God must be wholehearted. And that in the way of duty, there's to be no conferring with flesh and blood to find out whether or not you ought to do what God said do. Come on. Come on. When God instructs his commissioned speaker, you don't have to meet with no group and ask them what do they think about it. Come on, come on. Come on now. Come on now. It was God who said, throw the rod down. It was God who said, put your hand in your robe. It was God who said, pour out the water, and it turned to blood. It was God who said, I'll be with you. I'll be with you. Go down and stand in front of Pharaoh. But Lord, he's a strong king. Stand there. I'll be with you, Moses. But you got to obey my word. But Lord, let's argue.
All right.
Come on, Duncan.
I'm going down to Egypt, and I'm going to risk my life. Now, does one little act of circumcision make all that big a difference? Is it really all that important? After all, nobody's going to see it anyhow, unless the boy's naked. Priest Charles, Priest Charles, nobody will ever know he's circumcised or not unless they accidentally see him with his clothes off. So does it make that much difference just to neglect to do one little thing?
Come on now.
One little thing. Yes, it does. Because if you neglect to do a little thing, you're going to neglect to do a bigger thing. So God said, I just might as well get this straight right now. So when I send Moses into Egypt, and he gets on foot and starts leading the people in the direction of the Red Sea, somebody's going to say, Moses, that's the wrong way. Mm-hmm. Moses, there's a better way to go. Moses, if you just go up north, you don't have to cross the Red Sea. But the Lord said, Moses, lead them to the Red Sea. So I got to have somebody who will listen to me when I speak to them and do what I say. Amen. 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 God wants those who will lead his people out of bondage to the promised land to be able to say, as Paul said, follow me as I follow you. Not we'll follow you. Follow me as I follow the Lord. Did you hear the language? Follow me as I follow the Lord. Do you hear the language? I'm not to follow you. You are to follow me. Well, how do you know where you're going? The Lord will tell me. And then I'm supposed to go the direction the Lord tells me. And you're supposed to fall in behind me.
Yes, sir.
But Lord, does not that put us at the mercy of the preacher? No, it does not. No, it does not. No, it does not. Because you can tell a wolf by the clothes he wears. Just follow along behind him with the word open. That's all you have to do. That's all you have to do. When he turns to the right, read the word. When he turns to the left, read the word. Read the word. Read the word. God wants men standing here who will say, I ought to obey God rather than men. God wants men who will stand here when people frown and say, I ought to obey God. God wants men who will do his word. So God had to meet Moses at the end. God had to correct Moses. God had to chastise Moses. How could Moses lead the people to love and obey God when he himself was having problems obeying God? How could Moses teach people to put God first if he put his wife first? Come on, come on. Come on now. God had enough sense to know there'll be some times when I call Moses and Zipporah's gonna say, Moses, stay home. I'm not talking about you. Moses, I want you to go down and lead Israel somewhere. Zipporah, Moses, you've been out of here Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Moses, I'm getting lonesome now. Moses, don't you think you ought to spend a little time at home? God said, I got to get it straight at the beginning. That when I speak, Moses, you're supposed to move. All the Moses of the 21st century must be prepared to sing with fervor and meaning, standing on the promises of God my King. Through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory in the highest. I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and winds assail, by the living word of God, I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises. I cannot fall. I can rock. I can lean. But I cannot fall. When I'm rooted and grounded in the promises of God, every moment I'm listening to the Spirit's call. I'm not listening to Ruth's voice. I'm not listening to trustee voice. I'm not listening to deacon voice. I'm not listening to any voice. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting, resting, resting in my Savior with my all in all. I'm standing. I'm standing. I'm standing. Yes. 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 Standing. 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 See, I don't want God to meet me at the end. I don't want God seeking ways to kill me. I want God to seek ways to love me. So son, son, you listen to God. You listen to God. Marcia, don't you be a Zipporah neither. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go. Because if the Lord seeks to kill you, the only thing saved him was obedience. And so Moses goes on down into Egypt and stops listening to other folks. Now that's your message.
I have to take a deep breath after that message, because I found myself, while the pastor was preaching, holding my breath. But this is an opportunity for anyone who has not accepted Christ as Lord and Savior to say, what must I do to be saved? We extend the invitation. We announce that
There is an open door. Jesus is that open door. And as the choir leads us in the invitation to him, if there is one, there may be one, two, or more who need to say yes to the Lord. Yes in salvation, or yes in church membership. We invite you to come. The Bible lets us know that if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. As the choir comes to sing, would you stand where you are? If you're responding to the invitation, would you come down the aisle? You can give the preacher your hand, but give the Lord your heart. Seated.
First of all, I'm going to turn to Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 15 in the NIV. I'll be very brief. Reverend Duncan, it reads, "Then I will give you shepherds after my own heart, who will lead you with knowledge and understanding." We must recognize, and I want to charge you today to recognize, first of all, who chose you to be here. He said, "I will give you shepherds after my own heart." Therefore, Duncan, you recognize that as a shepherd, you ought to have the heart of God. Amen. And in order to have a heart of God and maintain that heart, you must stay in the Word.
Yes,
sir. The church may have voted and given their opinion and shown you all this love, but God is the one that called you.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, recognize that actually you are not the shepherd. You are the under-shepherd, under the shepherd. And so we get our orders from the shepherd, as we shepherd the people on this earth. It goes on to say, who will lead you with knowledge and understanding. So, Reverend, you were brought here to lead the people with knowledge and understanding. And one of the things that congregations don't understand is that God has called you, and he's going to give you some understanding that they just don't have. They may have a lot of knowledge and all of that, but God gives you as the pastor the knowledge to lead and guide the congregation through.
Come on now.
That's the word. That's the word. We're going to look at another scripture. Let's look at Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. Verse 18. So first of all, know that God has called you as the pastor, and he's going to lead you and guide you. The next thing we see here Luke 4:18, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. Duncan, I charge you, never try to preach without the Spirit of the Lord upon you. When we preach or pastor in the flesh, we become just like everybody else. And so when the Spirit of the Lord is on us, we will say things and we will do things that are ordered by the steps of the Lord, ordered by the word of the Lord. Keeping in the time, one more scripture. 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning with verse 2. Sometimes there may be doubts about your pastor, but know that God called you. Sometimes you may not feel like preaching, but call on the Lord. His Spirit will get you through. And thirdly, 2 Timothy 4, beginning with verse 2, it says, preach the word.
Yeah.
As your father has alluded to, not their word, but God's word.
Yes, sir.
Be prepared in season and out of season, but preach. It says, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instructions. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Discharge all the duties of your ministries. Duncan, I say to you, whatever comes, preach. God called you to preach. God called you to pastor, but he also called you to preach. And when God calls you to preach, you may have heartburn on Sunday morning, but you got to preach. When God calls you to preach, you may be tired and you may be criticized, but God called you to preach. I'm about to quit, but he said preach in season and out of season. Let me see. There will be baseball seasons where people want to hit you upside the head, but you got to preach. There will be football seasons where folk will try to tackle you, Doc, but you got to preach. There will be basketball seasons when they will come in and slam dunk you, but you got to preach. One of the poets said, living above with folk that we love, oh, that will be glory. But living below with some church folk we know, now that's a different story. Sometimes it gets rough, Doc. But God said preach. In season, out of season. Preach when you're happy. Preach when you're sad. Preach. Preach. Preach when your soul gets happy. Just keep on preaching. Preach till your hair gets nappy. Just keep on preaching. Preach until the Lord says, well done.
Yes, sir.
Well done, Duncan. Yes. My good and faithful servant. Yes. God bless you, Doc.
Amen. 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 Amen.
To Pastor Duncan, Sister Duncan, and family, my ministerial friends, whoever they may be, brothers or sisters, my ministerial friends, some of us have been summoned to the court. And when we are summoned to court to be a part of the jury, they give us instructions. And so it's my responsibility in giving charge to the church to give some instructions to the church on this occasion. I want to say two things, Brother Booker, Brother Duncan. I don't know how long it's going to take me, but I really want to just say two things. And after 45 years serving in this church, I think if anybody knows something to say to the church, the Lord has given me something to say from experience. And Dr. Duncan, I hope to spend the rest of my days sharing with some churches. And after 45 years in one church, I think I have something to say to any church. I knew Brother Duncan when he was, I may be saying about, but I believe you were 23 years old. And I have detected in him for ever since I've known him 23 years ago, something about the love of God. Now, if a church needs to know anything, it needs to know of the reality of the love of God in the pastor-people relationship. I have a friend who said to me, Reverend Goatley, I want to know what your three last messages are. And I installed that young man about 30 years ago. And I remember what my message at the church where he started, just like you, as a new pastor. And my message on that occasion, I found it in writing. I'm going to send it to him. My message on that occasion to the church and pastor was, I will always be in love with you. A pastor learns something when he and a people can say to each other, I will always be in love with you. Now, Brother Charles, I sometimes call him, I think you and I know something about that element in church life. And I'm coming down on the floor to say this real quiet. When I came here 45 years ago, there were some of the old saints. I'm not saying everybody's old as a saint, but I'm telling you there were some experienced saints. I'll call one of them, the name was Willie Fisher. He said to me, Reverend Goatley, we may not be able to pay you all that you desire or need. He said, but God will pay you what you need. Now, you don't understand that. Some of you all don't understand that. But some of the old folks used to say that my God will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. If there's anybody in this church that doesn't understand that, I'm a walking example that my God has supplied all of my needs according not to the riches of the church, but according to his riches in glory.
Amen.
And I'm glad that God has blessed you. And some people are not going to like it because God has blessed you. I'm trying to sit down. But see, I've been around long enough. I've been around a long time. I've served 500 churches in the state and in the district. And some people don't realize that God can bless his servant. Brother Duncan, that's shouting time for you now. God blesses his servant. And you look like you've been blessed. Brother T. Vaughn, why don't you say amen there so I can sit down.
Let us all put our hands on him. Eternal God, giver of every good and every perfect gift, in whom we live and move and have our being. Our gathering here today is a witness to the unfinished nature of the church. For it within your divine will that a church should have a pastor and a pastor should have a flock. And so you have touched another one of your churches again in sending this young man to stand before them and lead them from Egypt into Canaan. So we pray, dear God, that you will be with him, that you will guide him, that you will continue to manifest your presence to him. Keep him, eternal God, from a love that grows cold. Keep him from becoming discouraged. Keep him from throwing up his hands in disgust. But keep on reminding him that through patience and faith, all things are possible. Bless this church. Bless his family. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, for now and forever. Amen. 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 Kentucky, not overlooking the first lady, someone else will come and present you.
All right.
I am happy, and you ought to be happy. As I present to you your pastor. As of this moment, officially, this is his pulpit.
Before I give my remarks, I wouldn't feel right if Dr. T. Von Walker, the moderator of the Central District Baptist Association, did not come and have words of greeting.
I know the hour is late, but on behalf of the 150 or so churches of the Central District Baptist Association, we are excited and delighted that God has appointed you to this place of service. This has been one of our leading churches in supporting the work of Central District. It has produced a fine moderator for our association, and we look forward to you carrying on the legacy that has already been laid out before you. God bless you. We pledge our prayers and support for you and your wife and this church. God bless you.
And also, before I have my remarks, I'm going to ask Sister Virginia Henderson, is she here, to come and present the First Lady.
Installed today, Pastor Reverend Charles Duncan, Jr. We, the members of First Baptist Church, want to welcome you as the First Lady of First Baptist Church, Eminence. I'm going to say Marcia because I know you so well. We've loved you for a long time. You right at home with us, honey. You grew up here, Sunday school, Red Circle girl. You were all of those things right here in First Baptist. God loved you then, and we love you now, and we welcome you as the First Lady of First Baptist Church, Eminence. Amen. May God bless you, richly bless you, and your husband, Reverend Duncan. Thank you, Pastor Duncan.
Thank you. Would you like to say anything?
Little did I know that when I came to this church when I was 8 years old that I would be standing in this place. My pen pal here, who's been keeping me up with my church for all this many years, has really been there for me, and my church has always been there for me. In the letter that I wrote Reverend Goatley a long time ago, didn't know it was quite that, 12 years ago, I was talking about how much I do love this church and how I could not, even at that time, bring myself to moving my membership to another church. I never knew at that time, and no one else could have told me that my life would have been changing so drastically within the past 24 months. Not only not expecting to move back to Kentucky, but also becoming a wife, a new stepmother, and now the First Lady. Please be with me and my husband. If any of you all that know me well, I'm not a natural leader, I'm a natural worker. So I feel that that is where God wants me to be. And I thank you, and I appreciate your prayers, and I will continue to pray for all of us. And I thank First Virginia Avenue, especially, for being here, bring the wonderful music. Thank you.
I hope that if I forget to say anything, you will forgive me. I'm aware of the time, and I would like to go home and just let this all sink in. And I know you would like to go home as well. I thank my Father for that word. I thank Reverend Booker for the charge to me. And I thank Pastor Goatley, who is my pastor, for the charge to the church. I thank all these ministers for being here today. And I thank all of you for being here today. When I think about my life, I'm just blessed. And I know I don't deserve it. I'm just blessed. Now, somewhere in this, my father's message today, he said, Moses said, that's the way to be, God. That's the way to go, God. And I said to Marcia, I say that all the time. When God does something for me, I say that's the way to go, God. When I'm studying his word and he opens my mind to something, I say that's the way to go, God. He's good. I have never in my life been placed in a position of leadership that compares to this in any way. And the moment I said that, God said, that's right. You haven't. He said, but you have been in a position of being a follower. And you've been a good follower.
All right.
And a good follower can make a good leader. And I said, and I'm speaking to First Baptist Eminence, I said that to say to you, God didn't tell me to say that to you. That was my decision. And what I'm trying to say is that when I stand here, I'm not going to tell you that God told me to say something to you that he didn't tell me. Everything God wants me to say, he has already said it. And And that's what I'm going to say to you. That what I just said earlier, that was something I wanted to share with you. And God said that to me. And I just shared it with you. But what he says to me that he wants me to say to you, it's in here. He's already said it. And he just wants me to repeat it and to remind you. Also, this is the last thing I'm going to say to First Baptist Eminence. God has decided to bless you through me. Now, I hope you can hear that. God has decided to bless you through me. And he's also decided to bless me through you. So all you and I have to do is work together and let God lead us. Let him lead me, and you come follow me as I follow him. And God will lead us where he wants us to go. I want to thank the kitchen committee. I want to thank everybody. I can't think of all who I need to thank, but I hope you know that I'm thankful for everything that you all did today. And it really means a lot to me, First Virginia Avenue, and Daddy, that you all came.
Amen.
To share this day with me. Before we sing "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds" and I give the benediction, I just want my family to stand.
Amen.
Amen.
I need to say one more thing. I didn't know back in 1975 when I first started coming up here. I wasn't a preacher then, wasn't thinking about it. But I had been raised in the church. And the church was in me when I came up here. The church is with me everywhere I go. God is with me everywhere I go. And so I was just being what God would have me to be. And I got involved in this church. And as my wife has said, lo and behold, all of this came to be. And I know God did it. I know he did. And I want to promise First Baptist Eminence, I'm going to give you all that I have. Because all I want to do is be a blessing to you. And I know that God is blessing me. Let us all stand, sing together, "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds." And after the benediction, I would appreciate it if you would come down and shake my wife's and my hand.
Blessed be the tie that binds.
Now, unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the throne of God with exceeding great joy, unto him be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let every heart sing.
Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen.
We hope you have enjoyed this worship service. Come join us at 5706 South Main Street in Eminence, Kentucky. Our services start each Sunday at 11 a.m. Thank you for joining us this day, and may God richly bless your life.